Hello, my name is Arno DeLorme, and this is part 11, the last part of a series on independent competent analysis applied to EEG time series. This part is about common misconceptions about ICA and some conclusions. And the first misconception is that ICA always work. You have EEG data, and sometimes whatever you do, you can't get a proper ICA decomposition. And by a proper ICA decomposition, I mean the decomposition with scalp map which are smooth, which can be represented by equivalent dipole. Sometimes they still look like a checkerboard. This dramatically depends on the quality of the data. If the data is of very low quality, there's a lot of noise in the data, you might end up with that. But sometimes we don't know why. We can't just get a decent decomposition. So ICA doesn't always work 100%. The second misconception is ICA can only be used to remove artifact in the EEG. And I hope through the series of presentation I was able to convince you that you can actually look at brain sources using ICA as well. And this is one of the slides that I presented where you can see the contribution of occipital alpha, frontal midline theta, and how ICA separates these components. A third misconception is that ICA adulterates the phase of the EEG signal. And this is an idea that was spread by Robert Thatcher, which is one of the main figures in qEEG analysis and neurofeedback. And he posted this video on YouTube that got a lot of attention. And we had a discussion on our mailing list with more than 50 message exchanges with Robert Thatcher. And we also put up a page with ICA phase distortion that you can see on our wiki, which discussed this topic and show that this is misfounded. To summarize in a few words, when you have artifacts like blinks, for example, if you look at blinks, yes, when you remove the blink, ICA is going to change the phase. This is actually a good thing because you remove the artifacts. So I invite you to go and look at this discussion in more detail if you're interested. There's a lot of expert contributing to this topic. The third, another misconception is that ICA should not be used for connectivity analysis of underlying brain sources. And this is more grounded in science than the previous one. It's based on the idea that ICA separates sources based on their independence. So why would you want to study the connectivity between this independent component, these components which are independent? And the idea here is that ICA is a maximum projection algorithm, so it's going to find the sources which are maximum independent. But there might be some residual dependence between the components. So this was actually studied in detail by Stephen Hoffer and collaborator in a paper in which they had simulated sources and they used different algorithms to separate the sources and calculate the connectivity. And in this simulation paper, ICA didn't necessarily fare well. You can see at the bottom here has the highest error of all the methods tested. But some other variants of ICA did fare well that they tested in this paper. Also, this was based on one specific ICA algorithm, and there are now more powerful algorithms such as PCAR that can obtain sources which are much more independent and much more, and it might work better in that case. The field right now is geared towards using distributed source modeling and then parcelating the brain into different brain areas and calculating the connectivity between these regions. But this has its own problem because ICA is data driven, so it's going to find the source in the brain which are specific to the subjects, and this is not data driven, so this might not work for all the subjects. We've published actually an article on the topic of using ICA to calculate connectivity analysis. And here this is using 7 brain different areas and grandeur causality between this area and show that ICA does a good job in this specific case. And we obtain some relevant connectivity analysis. The main issue with ICA and connectivity has to do with aggregating the data across subjects. Because as we saw in one of the previous presentations, some subjects might have the components, but you record the subject the next day and it might not have the same components. Some components might be missing. So how do you account for this missing data? And so that's the main challenge with looking at connectivity analysis using ICA across groups of subjects, is how do you account for the missing data? And so there've been some effort from our lab in that direction. One of them is called GroupSift, and that's a plugin to EEGLAB. That's basically is a solution to aggregate components across subjects. There's more effort based on Bayesian analysis with Wes Thompson at UCSD, and we hope it's going to move forward so we can use this solution and compare them with other types of solution for connectivity analysis. So finally, this is a list of paper we've published on the topic, and the link are in the description. And I want to acknowledge all the people who've contributed to this project, in particular, Ramon Martinez here on the left was one of the EEGLAB programmer. Makoto, which you might have seen on the EEGLAB list because he answers lots of the questions. Luca, who developed IC Label, which I talked about. Scott McKeag, of course, which is director of the lab, and Zipping Jung next to him, which is the co-director of the lab. And also Fiorenzo Ortoni here on the right. And Jason, so Fiorenzo contributed to Relica, Bootstrap ICA, and Jason Palmer, who developed Amica. And I also want to thank you for your attention. One of the questions I got in the comments and from all my colleagues was, why did I always have the same shirt on all this presentation? So I invite you to look at the following video to see if I've been able to change my shirt. Thank you.